Hi everybody, and welcome back. In this video, we'll be recreating a piece of chemistry history, the Wohler synthesis of urea. More specifically, we'll be performing a modified version of this classic experiment. For this experiment, you will need potassium cyanate, not cyanide, ammonium sulfate, isopropanol, and 95% ethanol. First, 13 grams of ammonium sulfate were dissolved in 20 milliliters of hot distilled water with heating and stirring until everything dissolved. Then, 8 grams of potassium cyanate were dissolved in 20 milliliters of hot distilled water. The mixture was stirred and heated until everything dissolved. The solutions were combined in an evaporating dish, and a little bit of potassium sulfate precipitated. Then, the solution was evaporated to dryness on the steam bath. During this time, some ammonia was formed. As such, it is advisable to conduct this step in a fume hood or well-ventilated area. While that happens, let's discuss the chemistry and significance of this experiment. It's history time! Before our modern knowledge of organic chemistry blossomed, there existed many theories about how and why chemical reactions happened. The modern way we define organic and inorganic compounds is a fairly dry, complex, and technical one. However, up until fairly recently, scientists had a different view. Early chemists regarded compounds which could be isolated from or produced by living organisms as organic, and all other compounds as inorganic. They also believed that organic compounds could only be produced by living organisms. This was part of the theory of vitalism, a now obsolete scientific theory which persisted until the 19th century for reasons that will become clear in a moment. It stated that living organisms possessed a certain special quote-unquote life force which enabled them to produce organic molecules, such as urea. Urea is a fairly prevalent molecule. In fact, it is the most prevalent molecule, aside from water, in human urine, and is also prevalent in the urine of other mammals. The theory of vitalism was shaken in 1828 when the German chemist Friedrich Wohler discovered his eponymous synthesis of urea by accident. It involved the combination of two inorganic compounds, silver cyanate and ammonium chloride, to form a solution of ammonium cyanate. When Wohler boiled the liquid to obtain the product, he found that, much to his astonishment, the product was not in fact ammonium cyanate as he had intended, but urea. Since Wohler converted two inorganic compounds into an organic compound, it disproved the theory of vitalism. Our modern version is a little different. We've substituted ammonium sulfate for ammonium chloride and the far less toxic potassium cyanate for the silver cyanate that Wohler used. Now, let's discuss what's happening here. In the first step of this synthesis, the ammonium salt and cyanate salt undergo a double displacement to form ammonium cyanate. When the solution is boiled to dryness, the ammonium cyanate undergoes thermal decomposition to form urea. The original silver cyanate and ammonium chloride reacted to form insoluble silver chloride, which was filtered off. In our case, potassium sulfate is formed, which we'll have to deal with in a slightly more complicated way. Now, why does this all matter? Urea, besides being the funny pea molecule, is one of the most produced chemicals on Earth. About 183 million tons of it were produced in 2022, and this number is only increasing. To put that in perspective, that is 0.54 tons of urea for everyone in the United States as of February 2024, which is a little over the weight of one polar bear, or about one-third the weight of your mom. Urea is mainly used as a nitrogen fertilizer. More than 90% of all urea produced sees use in agriculture. What's left is used in the manufacture of pharmaceuticals, explosives, polymers, cosmetics, and just about anything else you can imagine. Urea is nowadays produced almost exclusively by the reaction of ammonia and carbon dioxide under pressure, a much different process than that of Wohler. But the core idea of turning inorganic molecules into organic molecules is still much the same. Now, let's get back to the lab. The mixture was stirred and broken up as it dried. The dried mixture was then transferred to a 100 milliliter flask and extracted twice with 25 milliliter portions of boiling 95% ethanol. The extracts were filtered and combined. As much of the alcohol as possible was boiled away. The residue solidified into a mass of crude urea as it cooled. The crude urea was dissolved in boiling isopropanol. This took around 60 milliliters. The solution was then filtered and allowed to cool. The flask was then placed in the freezer overnight to precipitate as much product as possible, causing the flask to become filled with crystals. The crystals that formed were filtered off and washed with ice-cold isopropanol. After drying, 2.21 grams of product were obtained, corresponding to a 36.9% yield. Now, let's test to see if we have urea. For this, we will need a 0.5 molar solution of oxalic acid and a concentrated solution of potassium hydroxide. First, we will dissolve a little bit of our product in water. And add a few milliliters of 0.5 molar oxalic acid solution. After a few seconds, a crystalline precipitate of urea oxalate should be observed. And there it is. Next, let's dissolve a little more urea. And add some concentrated potassium hydroxide solution to it. If any ammonium salt is present, such as ammonium cyanate, it would be converted to free ammonia, which would detect with a wet piece of pH paper. As you can see, the pH paper remains unchanged. When the solution is boiled, however, ammonia gas is released, as evidenced by the change in color. This results from the hydrolysis of urea, which is an amide. Lastly, we will determine the melting point using a teal tube. We observe a range of 132 to 135 degrees Celsius. This melting point agrees very well with the published melting point for urea, which is 132 to 135 degrees Celsius. And with that, thanks for watching and I hope you enjoyed. I'm sorry that I haven't made many videos lately. School has occupied a lot of my free time, and I probably won't be able to make another video until June or July at the earliest.